You are the hand that catches my fall. You are the friend that answers my call. You are my day, and you are my night. You are my sin. You're everything, the beginning and end. You have my soul, my heart and my mind. You have my
yeah. And oh, for you
I sing, I guess, I rejoice in this divine romance. Lift my heart and my hands to show my love. And all for you, I sing, I dance, I rejoice in this divine.
Oh, hi. Well, it's the day after Christmas, and I hope that you're getting some time relaxing and just taking a breath, maybe enjoying your favorite cup of eggnog. I'm having a healthier option. It's potato nog. It's just as delicious, but less cholesterol. And I was just thinking about how strange it is when Christmas is over, that the day after Christmas is a little like you're waking from an odd dream, and you look around your house and go, why is there a tree in my house? It's odd that we put trees in our houses. Whether it's a live tree, or I don't know which is weirder, a live tree or a fake tree, but you have a tree in your house and you're sitting around going, did I really wear an elf hat out in public at one point in the last few weeks? And you're gonna get your credit card statement and go, oh my word, we spent how much money? The days after Christmas are a little disorienting because you're looking back at Christmas and going, what was I thinking? But I actually think that biblically, we're supposed to keep that Christmas feeling all year long. And I know that sounds trite and cliche, but I want to talk with you a little bit about what happened after the Christmas story. This isn't going to be long. I know you have a lot of things you want to do today. Returns, going to the mall, football games and whatnot. But I just want to read to you and kind of unpack a little bit about what happened after the Christmas story that we know so well. The Christmas story we've heard 100 times in the last month. The Christmas story that Linus tells Charlie Brown when he doesn't know what the true meaning of Christmas is. So we're going to pick it up right after the shepherds have left and the angels are done and Mary and Joseph are left there looking at this little baby. So we're going to look at Luke chapter 2. And in Luke chapter 2, we're going to hear about two people. We're going to hear about Simeon and Anna. Simeon and Anna. These are two people, two very important people, and two very old people. And we're going to get some truth from them. And hopefully it'll help us see the days after Christmas and maybe even the rest of the year a little bit differently. So it says in Luke chapter 2, verse 22, when the time came for the purification rites required by the law of Moses, Joseph and Mary took Jesus to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord and to offer a sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves or two young pigeons. So what this means is Mary and Joseph, they were good Jews. They were good Jewish people. They did the things that they were supposed to do. And so after the whole Bethlehem thing, after 8 days, it says in the passage right before this, Jesus was circumcised, and then they go down to do these purification rites down in Jerusalem, which is not that far from Bethlehem. And when they go there, this is a ritual cleansing because of Mary, and it's 30 some odd days after she's had a baby, and it's what all the Jews were required to do. And it actually says in Leviticus 12, isn't this great? It's Christmas time, we're going to talk about the Levitical law. It says in Leviticus 12, bring a year old lamb for a burnt offering and a young pigeon, and or catch this, this is the other option. I'm not making this up, this is in the King James Version, a turtle dove. When else have you heard of turtle doves except that godless, annoying song that we sing for the last month. But you could actually bring a turtle dove for a sin offering under the door of the tabernacle of the congregation unto the priest. And if you can't bring a lamb, bring two turtles or two pigeons, one for burnt offering, one for sin offering. In this way, the priest will make atonement for her and she'll be clean. So that's what was happening, is they were going down just like everyone would do. They would consecrate the first baby son, and then Mary was going to do these purification rites. And if you're interested in that, there's lots of exciting passages in the book of Leviticus about all of that. So that's what they're doing. And while they're there, they run into two people. So I want you to imagine this place. They're in the temple in Jerusalem, and it's busy. It's bopping along. There's all sorts of people coming and going. People coming to do purification rites just like this, coming to do other things, ablution, all this sort of stuff. And there's even people selling things there in the market. It's all just crazy. I just want you to picture a crazy, chaotic scene. And there's Mary and Joseph walking through, going to do their biblical duties, and they're walking along with this baby. And they are stopped. They're stopped by somebody. Verse 25. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon who was righteous and devout. What righteous means is this was not a guy who was doing the things the law told him not to do and devout. He believed firmly. Now, a quick thing about that word Simeon. So if you were Jewish and you were reading this passage back in the day and you saw the word Simeon, you didn't go, oh, I guess this guy's name was Simeon. You thought, oh, Simeon, that's one of the 12 tribes of the nation of Israel. But the 12 tribes of the nation of Israel, this Simeon tribe was not the most respected tribe. It was actually one of the least tribes. In fact, all sorts of not great things were spoken about the family of Simeon because of what the guy Simeon ended up doing. And so the tribe of Simeon was actually this really small tribe, and the land that they got was an enclave within a larger tribe's land, which was the tribe of Judah. Now, if you know your Bible at all, something in you hears that and perks up. So catch this. Simeon, the land of Simeon, was within the tribe of Judah. Well, who was from the line of Judah? David and Jesus. The tribe of Judah is here, and Simeon was tucked in right inside of the tribe of Judah. Jesus is called in Scripture the Lion of Judah. So we've got Simeon right there in the middle. And the word Simeon means hear. And some Hebrew translations say the word Simeon means to hear and obey, to hear and actually do what God is saying to do. So that's, I want you to picture all that's going around this guy's name, Simeon. And he's an old man. Let's read more. Simeon was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was on him. Now, at this point, we've been going through the book of Acts and Restoration, and we've been learning about the Holy Spirit. At this point, well before the book of Acts, the Holy Spirit just kind of came and went. It wasn't like if you were a believer, you had the Holy Spirit. At this time, the Holy Spirit kind of come on people and leave them. It was really hard to figure out who was going to land on, what it was going to do. But it said this old cat, Simeon, he was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and whoosh, the Holy Spirit was on him. So what do they mean by the consolation of Israel? It means that at this time, what is it, 0 AD, the nation of Israel was underfoot by the Romans. They were controlled by the Romans. And all of their normal ways of worshiping the Lord were fractured and broken. It was not a good time for Jewish people, for the nation of Israel. And so this guy, Simeon, was waiting for God to make things right. He was waiting for God to make things right. The word consolation, the Greek part of it is the paraklesis, which, again, if you know your Greek, which I don't know why you'd know your Greek, you'll sound familiar because the word paraklete is actually used to describe the Holy Spirit. It's the comforter. It's the counselor. So let's keep reading. It had been revealed to him, Simeon, by the Holy Spirit. Catch this. Old guy in the middle of Jerusalem. Evil Romans. And at some point, maybe in his prayer time, I don't know what, maybe he was walking around the lake, who knows what, but the Holy Spirit went boom. And it said, the Holy Spirit revealed to him that he, Simeon, would not die until he had seen the Lord's Messiah, the promised one. Moved by the Spirit. So I guess Simeon woke up that morning and was thinking, I guess I'll go do what I normally do, go down to Hardee's and eat a biscuit. That's what old people do. And then it says, no. He was moved by the Spirit, and he went to the temple court. Something in him said, get thee to the temple. And he went, I'll go and obey. And then when he's there, he's probably just standing there going, I don't know why I'm here, God, but all right. And then he sees these two people walking towards him, and they're carrying a baby. And something in him, when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God. Okay, so catch this. Imagine your mom and dad walking along some church thing or whatever, and some old guy comes up and goes, I'm going to hold your baby now because the Holy Spirit has told me to. What? But sure enough, Simeon takes Jesus from them and holds them. And I'm sure Mary and Joseph are going, ah, what's going on? This is a man of faith and longing, and something in him knew that the very thing he was hoping for was right there. It was right there in this child. In that moment, he sensed God saying, it's happening. The thing you've been waiting for is happening. And what's his response? He starts singing. He makes up a song on the spot. Now, if you're Mary and Joseph, okay, someone's taken your child and is holding them, and then all of a sudden starts singing, which, oddly enough, is what Mary did when she found out she was pregnant with Jesus, which is what Zechariah did when they found out that they were pregnant with John the Baptist, which is what the angels did at the Advent. Here's his song. It's called the Nunc Dimittis, which is Latin that sounds like I made up, but it's actually real, and it's the way they describe the first two words of this. And the song goes like this: Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace, meaning I can die. You've heard the phrase, I can die a happy man. That's what he was saying. I can die now. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and the glory of your people in Israel. Very important. He doesn't just say Jesus has come to set right the Jews. He says Jesus has come, this little baby has come to also set right those outside the nation of Israel. Luke, the author of this gospel, he was a Gentile. He always wanted to make sure that everyone understood who read this, that Jesus did not just come from the Jew, but he also came for most of us, the Gentiles. So this is the song. Simeon doesn't need to see Jesus' life. He knows in the moment, as if watching a farmer drop a seed and go, I know everything's going to be fine. It's all going to be fine because I've seen this. And then Simeon turns to the parents. The child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. They're starting to get a sense. Mary already knew this, but I think both of them together are getting a sense that this Jesus really is the Son of God. Then Simeon blessed them. I'm sure he held the baby back at this point, and said to Mary, his mother, this child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your heart also. So, I mean, he takes the baby, he looks at the baby, he's so excited, he sings this wonderful song, he hands it back, and then he says something very challenging to Mary and to Joseph. And he says, this child is going to cause pain for you, and it's going to cause pain to the nation of Israel, but ultimately it will be good. He could have said, wow, Jesus is here. Jews, it's all going to be daisy farms and puppies. It's all going to be great. But he doesn't, because he knows, the Holy Spirit has revealed to him, that's not the case. That this Jesus will be a dividing spot. He will be a stone on which people will break apart. You will either choose Jesus to believe and obey, or you will not choose him and walk away. And he says, it's so interesting, he just says something very personal to Mary. He says, your heart is going to be hurt. And what he means is, your son will die a very painful death. But it's all wrapped up in the fact that this is ultimately good. So Simeon has stopped these people. He has prophesied over them. He said what is coming, and he marvels at what God is doing and praises him. So that's Simeon. Hot on the heels of Simeon is this woman named Anna. Anna's story is similar to Simeon's, but a little bit different. It says in verse 36, right after that, there was a prophet. Now, a prophet is someone who hears from God and says what God is saying. There is a prophet named Anna, the daughter of Penuel of the tribe of Asher. So again, if you're Jewish, you're going ding, ding, ding. There's three things right there that you're going, huh, that's interesting. Anna is sort of a modern version of the name Hannah. And Hannah in the Old Testament was a woman who just wanted a child, wanted a male child. And ultimately, who was her child? Samuel, the first real powerhouse prophet of the Old Testament who ministered to David. So we've got Hannah and we've got Anna. Not only that, but it says she was the daughter of Penuel. And again, if you're Jewish, you go, Penuel? That's Peniel, which was the name of the place where Jacob in the Old Testament wrestled God. Peniel means the face of God. And finally, she was of the tribe of Asher. And by the way, I just think this was interesting. I didn't know this till I started studying this week. The tribe of Asher was the happy tribe. That word Asher actually means happy. And they were blessed. Moses said of this tribe of Israel, y'all are just blessed, like prosperity and good things. You're just happy. It's like fat bread is sort of the idea that Moses speaks of them. Everything's just going to be good. Like it's just a happy time. So you kind of got Simeon who's going, wow, man, this is good but hard. And then you've got Anna, and I just picture her, this wonderful old woman who's blessing people. And it says of her, it says, so Jacob, oh, I'm sorry. It says she walks up. She's very old. She had lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, meaning they were married for 7 years, and then this man died. And then she was a widow until she was 84. So she's 84 years old, which is old today, and back in that day was even older. She never left the temple, but worshiped night and day, fasting and praying. She was waiting on something. Coming up to them, Mary and Joseph, at that very moment, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were looking forward to the redemption of Jerusalem. So Anna sees this baby. She's been preparing. She's been worshiping and fasting and praying, and she sees the baby and she gives thanks. Not only that, she told the other people around, are you waiting for the Messiah? This little baby is the Messiah. So you have Mary and Joseph walking through the temple courts, and they're stopped two times. One by an old man named Simeon who goes, this is the child. Another time by this old woman, Anna, who says, this is the child. It's what we have been waiting on. So imagine you're in those temple courts and all the people walking by, and none of them notice Jesus. They're so busy going about their business, going about their lives, going about their relationships, going about their work, going about their activities, their fun, whatever it is, and they just don't stop to notice the child. And we don't want to be people like that. One of the things I love about Christmas, aside from the assorted nogs, is that this is a time when we, in some form or fashion, stop down a little for at least a few weeks and at least try to make ourselves think of the child. But it shouldn't end then, right? I don't think Simeon and Anna the next day woke up and went, what was that about? Anyway, I guess I'll just go about doing what? No. Their lives were driven by the fact that they had an interaction with the Holy Son of God, the one who had set them and anyone who believed in him right with God, gave them right standing. We need to be people like that. We need to be people who daily do what Simeon and Anna do. And what I think they do is this. And it says it, even when they talk about Simeon holding the baby, what they do is this, they receive. They receive him. And I would say I would argue that that verb receive is maybe one of the most powerful verbs in all of your Bible. We are meant to do a lot of things and tell people the gospel and do this and believe that. And I get it. That's all really important. But I know for me, it all really boils down to, and this is the seed from which everything else grows, is that we're meant to receive him. Simeon received Jesus into his arms. And the passage that I love about this is in the Gospel of John. John says this, John wrote strange about Jesus, but it's real beautiful. John was like the kooky uncle when it comes to the Gospels. John wrote, the true light that gives light to everyone has come into the world. He was in the world, he walked around on earth, and though the world was made through him, it didn't recognize him. He came to that which was his own, the Jews, but his own did not receive him. Here we go, verse 12. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. Yet to all who receive him, he gives the right to become children of God. We don't just receive him one time. I received him when I was 12. I received him when I was 22. I received him when I was... Okay, great. I believe we're meant to receive him every day. And when we receive him every day, when we sit and just stop down just for a few moments and marvel at the fact that God sent his one son to give us right standing, to clear all of our sins away, and give meaning to our lives. If we just spend a few minutes on here, December 26th, and the 27th, and the 28th, and in January, and February, and into the spring, and so all the every day, we're meant to receive him. We're meant to receive him. And when we do, that Christmas marveling that we've experienced the last few weeks, it doesn't end. Christmas keeps going. Not in the sweater way or the tree in your living room way, but in the right way because we receive him. So let me pray for us. Father, I thank you for Simeon and I thank you for Anna. And I thank you that they teach us the lesson that we are meant to receive you. And I ask for everybody who's watching today or sometime in the future, that they would receive you and enjoy what it means to be called a child of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Ah.
I'm returning to the secret place. Just an altar and a flame. Love is found here in our sacred space. I hear your voice, I see your face. And you're still my first love. You're still. There's a table just for you and me. Break the bread and pour the wine. Perfect union, nothing in between. I am yours, you are mine. And you're still. You're still my and you're still.